Reading the Quran leaves very little to the imagination that Muhammad equates himself with Allah in hundreds of verses. More of them I found also in the hadiths. What are your impressions?
Muhammad's quarrel with his fellow tribesmen, the Quraysh, and the other pagan Arabs was not based on their lack of knowing Allah, since they knew him as the supreme god of the Kaaba long before Muhammad was born. The whole of Muhammad's calumny and diatribes in his Quran against the pagan Arabs was simply because they associated other gods with Allah. Muhammad never claimed to have received his message directly from Allah, neither did he allege that he met him face to face. Nonetheless, Allah was extremely attentive to the requests and demands of Muhammad for almost 23 years. All of Muhammad's revelations were very conveniently descended or revealed to him as and when he needed them. Each revelation was to justify an action, a deed, or a desire that Muhammad committed or required. These revelations became more and more frequent, as well as invariably very specific as time progressed. It seems that Allah was very mindful of Muhammad's needs, political, religious, judicial, as well as carnal, sometimes on a daily basis. Even his teenage, very young wife was surprised enough to tell the following. Sahih al-Bukhari hadith 6.311, narrated by Aisha. I used to look down upon those ladies who had given themselves to Allah's apostle, and I used to say, can a lady give herself to a man? But when Allah revealed, you, O Muhammad, can postpone the turn of whom you will, of them your wives, and you may receive any of them whom you will, and there is no blame on you if you invite one whose turn you have set aside temporarily. Chapter 33.51, I said to the Prophet, I feel that your Lord hastens in fulfilling your wishes and desires. Allah of the Quran is a very severe and unmerciful God to all of humanity, his own creations, excepting, of course, to Muhammad and his followers, upon whom he showers rewards both on earth and infinitely greater ones in paradise. Allah of the Quran gives divine sanctions to Muhammad and his followers to murder, rape, pillage, loot, enslave and plunder all of humanity who do not believe in his unity and in Muhammad as his messenger. It is the only belief system in human history which arrogates to itself that it alone should be the only one to exist on the face of the earth, and which has declared total war on all of humanity to achieve this divine purpose. During his Meccan period, when Muhammad was weak and with little support, he was very humble vis-à-vis Allah. His verses during this period were conciliatory, meaningful, and similar in tone and content to the Hebrew prophets that he assiduously and slavishly tried to emulate. His attitude changed dramatically, and for the worse, after he became the head of a piratical and terroristic criminal organization based in Medina. His verses became full of hate, anger, unmerciful, and arrogant. He started associating his name simultaneously with Allah in an often repeated mantra of Allah and his messenger or Rasul. Al-Ahzab 33.36. It is not fitting for a believer, man or woman, when a matter has been decided by Allah and his apostle, to have any option about their decision. If anyone disobeys Allah and his apostle, he is indeed on a clearly wrong path. Allah curses those who curse Muhammad. Al-Ahzab 33.57. Those who annoy Allah and his apostle, Allah has cursed them in this world and in the hereafter, and has prepared for them a humiliating punishment. Allah listened to Muhammad's wife's gossip and reported them to Muhammad in Quranic verses. Al-Ahzab 33.32. O consorts of the Prophet, ye are not like any of the other women. If ye do fear Allah, be not too complacent of speech, lest one in whose heart is a disease should be moved with desire. But speak ye a speech that is just, and establish regular prayer, and give regular charity, and obey Allah and his apostle. When Muhammad lusted for Zainab, the wife of his adopted son, Zayd, the usual convenient revelation was descended, overturning centuries of Arabian tradition, allowing Muhammad to take her away from his son. Al-Ahzab 33.37. Behold, thou didst say to one who had received the graces of Allah and thy favor, retain thou in wedlock thy wife and fear Allah. But thou didst hide in thy heart that which Allah was about to make manifest. Thou didst fear the people, but it is more fitting that thou should fear Allah. Then, when Zayd had dissolved his marriage with her, with the necessary formality, we joined her in marriage to thee. When his child bride Aisha was accused of adultery, another revelation from Allah exonerated her. Al-Nur 24.4. And those who launch a charge against chaste women and produce not four witnesses to support their allegation, flog them with 80 stripes and reject their evidence ever after, for such men are wicked transgressors. When guests overstayed their welcome after Muhammad's wedding to Zainab, Allah revealed the verse of the hijab, in which Allah also teaches the believers what manners they should have vis-à-vis their mentor Muhammad. Al-Ahzab 33.53. O ye who believe, enter not the Prophet's houses until leave is given for you for a meal, and then not so early as to wait for its preparation. But when you are invited, enter, and when you have taken your meal, disperse without seeking familiar talk. Such behavior annoys the Prophet. He is ashamed to dismiss you, but Allah is not ashamed. Allah la yastahi to tell you the truth. And when ye ask his ladies for anything you want, ask them from before a veil, min wara'i hijabi. That makes for a greater purity for your hearts and for theirs. Nor is it right for you that you should annoy Allah's apostle, or that you should marry his widows after him at any time. Truly, such a thing is in Allah's sight an enormity. Al-Fath 48.9. In order that you, O men, may believe in Allah and his apostle, that you may assist and honor him and celebrate his praises morning and evening. Al-Hujurat 49.1. O ye who believe, put not yourselves forward before Allah and his apostle. Al-Hujurat 49.14. But if ye obey Allah and his apostle, he will not belittle aught of your deeds. Only those are believers who have believed in Allah and his apostle and have never sinned. Al-Hadid 57.7. Believe in Allah and his apostle and spend in charity out of the substance wherefore he has made you heirs. There are hundreds more of such verses, subliminally associating in the indoctrinated minds of Muhammad's followers an image of an intimate and equal relationship between Allah and Muhammad. So much so that one cannot find a single instance of the calligraphies of Muhammad's name that is not equal in size and height to that of Allah in any mosque or piece of art. Muhammadans revere Muhammad in greater and more violent measures than Allah, as they have demonstrated repeatedly, from Salman Rushdie's satanic verses to the Danish cartoons. Ladies and gentlemen, all the hundreds of Quranic verses that represent anomalies, hatreds, warmongering, satans, jinn, plunder, looting, slaughtering, and other strange happenings can be easily explained the moment one comes to the only possible and logical conclusion. There is not a single letter, let alone a word, a verse, ayah, or a chapter, surah in the Quran that is conceivably the product of any omniscient, compassionate, and merciful divinity. So-called believers and unbelievers, the Quranic verses actually reflect Muhammad's frame of mind during his 23 years ministry, his hatreds, his lusts, his jealousies, his envy, his fears, his anger, his contempt, his proclivities, etc. In summation, the Quran is in reality Muhammad's psychological profile. The Quran is Muhammad's own alter ego, but cleverly projected into the unsuspecting mouth of Allah, the supreme pagan rock god of Muhammad's tribe of Quraysh, in Mecca. Ladies and gentlemen, believers and unbelievers, Allah, Gabriel, Satan, and Muhammad are actually one and the same, Muhammad himself.